So thank you for the invitation to talk again about residencies. I think one of the, in what I'd originally spoken about, one of the key points I wanted to make was that residencies have now become a more or less ubiquitous part of a larger art world system. So they've taken a place alongside a kind of set of institutions that are involved in a system of what I think, I'm trying to remember who it is, Baxendal calls subscription, the acquiring of value around particular artists, around particular bodies of work, through a complex system of endorsement, institutional endorsements through art schools, galleries, museums, and then also residency programs. So they've become a kind of important part of artists' CVs and a context in which their practice, in which they can network, engage with the whole social, institutional world and become visible to curators, writers, and so on. The origins of artists in residence programs, I think, show some interesting core or point to some interesting core features of residencies. So from their early origins in the sort of late 19th, early 20th century, both in America and in New York, they were on the one hand projects which were initiated by art patrons wanting to support the work of artists, and on the other hand, spaces that were developed by artists themselves as artist-run and artist-initiated projects. And in both instances, I think from the quite early moments of residency programs, there was both the idea that they offered a kind of retreat on the one hand, and a kind of engagement with a wider social world on the other. And those two different aspects, I think, have become more and more pronounced over the years in different ways, and there have been different permutations of this idea of arts in residence as a kind of retreat into oneself, as well as arts in residence program as being engaging with an entirely new context, engaging with the social world, engaging with public practice, particular contexts, and so on. And across the, I mean, there are now literally hundreds of these programs all over the world. The Res Artist Cyclists, about 550 of organizations. And if you look at, for example, the South African entry, it only includes, they don't mention at least three or four organizations in the country, like the Bag Factory, for example, isn't mentioned there. So they lost that article mentioned there. But across all of these organizations, one now gets a lot of different sorts of models and ways of thinking about what arts and residence programs are, and a kind of what?
the tables shaking.
Sorry. And a kind a kind of diversity of approach, a diversity of funding models, and diversity in what's offered. So, I mean, broadly, I think the key points to be made for people who are kind of coming into the industry, coming into professional practice, is that these programs can provide a really valuable kind of stepping stone, a moment for professional development, for networking, and for taking forward new bodies of work. So you can have really a mixture of all of these different dimensions of what residencies are that really become tailored to what it is that you as an individual artist are wanting to achieve and get out of it. And I would say that one of the most important things is for people going into an arts and in residence, into residency or applying for a residency is to have a degree of clarity about really what they want to get out the other end. And as someone who's read a lot of applications for us, residencies of different kinds in different organizational and institutional settings, this is a kind of quite simple but quite obvious point that is really very often overlooked in the way that arts apply to these things. Often they just really talk about their work in a general way as though it's self-evident how marvelous and special and unique it is and how obvious it is that they should be given this space and time and these resources to pursue that work in some way. So what one is really looking for, I think, generally, being a bit on the receiving end of these kinds of applications and submissions, is a certain kind of clarity about what people want to get out of it at a professional level, at a creative level, at a personal level. And that can be a diversity of things. There isn't only one thing, but that's really important, both for yourself and in order to be able to make a strong argument and strong motivation within what is usually a competitive field of lots of other artists wanting to access those kinds of opportunity. So it's maybe worth also in that context outlining a bit about the work that we do as Pralvetsi as just one example of an organization that supports residencies. There are two dimensions to that support. One is through involved in supporting residencies in both directions between Switzerland and the Southern African region. So artists, curators, cultural practitioners from Switzerland coming here, as well as artists, curators, organizers, festival directors, and so on, from Southern Africa going to Switzerland. And we offer two types of residency. One is aimed a bit more at kind of mediators, curators, organizers, which are short research residencies, up to between a week and a month, which are aimed at providing people with an opportunity to really network with, engage with a different art scene, with a view to them then potentially developing collaborative projects that we might then subsequently support. So where people come to us with the beginnings of an idea and perhaps the beginnings of network people that they'd like to have an opportunity to, people, institutions that they'd like to have an opportunity to potentially develop a project with, then we can support that for between like a week and a month, again in either direction, either from there to here or from here to there. We then also offer longer residencies, which are usually but not exclusively based at artists and artists across all of the various disciplines, so from music to performing arts to visual arts, digital arts, and so on. And we offer longer 3-month residencies, also in both directions. And these are really aimed at artists having the opportunity to really explore a new context, develop new work, that we don't necessarily expect people to, at the end of it, have any particularly concrete outcome. So it's very open-ended in terms of what kind of result is expected. We do expect some minimal kind of engagement with the local context, whether it's a presentation or a workshop or something along those lines. And comparatively, both those short and those long residencies are very well resourced. So we cover more or less everything. PMs, living expenses, accommodation, workspace rental, international travel, local travel. So it is a comparatively very generously resourced program, which I think particularly for us from our region is important, because I think for a lot of artists are having to support themselves through other kinds of work. The idea of then having to open above that then pay for an arts and residence program in another context while they're having to sustain their life in their own context, then is, you know, quite a challenging thing. So it's kind of cognizant of those realities as well. So really, yeah, trying to create opportunities for the widest possible cross-section of people. So that's the one side of our work. The other side of our work is really supporting mobility and residencies within the SADC region itself. So there's no necessary Swiss connection. So we have money financed through the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, which enables us to support the ability of artists and mediators, curators, organizers, and so on, within the to move within the region, normally to spend up to a month in another context, which can be about developing a new project, collaborating with another artist, and so on. It's also quite open-ended. And that is also about addressing the reality that a lot of the residency opportunities that are available to artists from South Africa, Southern Africa, continent more generally, militate towards artists going to Europe or North America and now increasingly Asia, which are well-resourced contexts that are able to pay for residencies and so on, which then produces a weird kind of tilt in the dynamics of the global art world towards those sorts of contexts as being the horizon of kind of greatest ambition. So we're interested in ways in which one can really invest in building a kind of regional and continental fabric of connection, collaboration, network, which can then in turn engage with the rest of the world, but as with those other parts, the world has an opportunity to speak to itself and to network and connect internally. So historically, it would be easier for someone in, say, Kinshasa to collaborate with someone in Strasbourg and to collaborate with someone in Johannesburg. And so with this finance, we try to address that kind of issue. So we've had people from Congo, so kind of in 2017, we'll have an artist and a curator from Congo spending time developing a project about race in Madagascar. There'll be a curatorial collective from Johannesburg also spending time in Madagascar developing a project around jazz and a kind of jazz musical exchange between Madagascar and South Africa. The collaborations between Angola and the DRC, between Zimbabwe and Congo, so sort of in all different directions. And there we're also interested in addressing the kind of, or trying to balance the role that South Africa as a country plays within the region as well, where generally South Africa is always the place that people come to. And looking at ways in which we can really build more and more connection between other countries in the region among each other, and not always necessarily South Africa being at the center of that dynamic. In exploring this kind of diversity of kinds of residencies and models and financing models and approaches, Assemblage has assembled an interesting mix of people. We've recently been involved in residencies in different parts of the world, from New York through to Iran, through to Paris, Nantes in France, and the Atelier residency in Finland. I think that covers all of them. And they all vary in duration and the financial means involved and the expectations of the hosts, and it will be interesting to hear about this kind of diversity of experience in getting some concrete substance to this idea of residencies.
So I'm going to stand here, since I'm the closest. I also don't know if everyone can hear me, and if you can't hear me, just please put up your hand, because I tend to forget that I'm not always hearing. So I'd say that the residences for me are an economic imperative more than anything else. If I had to pay rent, I would have to find out somewhere I wouldn't be able to make the work that I make. I'm not the kind of artist that can pay my rent by selling work. And that is something that I learned here at Assemblage 1 year when I had a studio. It was either full-time teaching job or make the work and not be paid for it. As an artist, we often have that problem. So when you go on a residency, if you don't have to pay rent who you are, if you own a property, like then that's one way that it facilitates making work. So these are two photos from my Instagram account. Dorsey on Wednesday is taking this something on the road. And then Paris on Thursday. In 2015 I won the Bombs of the Year Award, which was highly expected for me. So I've just been making work all along and trying to figure out how to keep going. And they said, well, they're sending me to Paris. And I was like, well, what's in Paris? So I didn't write a proposal for this. It was not something I applied for in any way. And I had to figure out when I got to Paris what I'm going to do. The city there was built in the 1970s by architect couple. It's literally across the road from the Seine in the Marais, which is the most expensive part of Paris. So you can imagine how expensive it is to live there as well, but it's really glamorous. All the tourists want to be there. It's across the road from the Ngoyi. So as a touristic experience, it's very interesting. But a cup of coffee will cost you 60 rand, same thing for a glass of wine, and then they'll feel like halfway. So I'm really feeling everything. This is the studio at the Zavale's app. So the panoramic shot looks a bit bigger than it really is. But as you can see, you live, eat, work, and sleep in the same space. That's kind of how it works. The view was not of the Seine, although some of the South African studios actually do have a view of the Seine. And there are three ways you can go to the city. So the one is to apply from Sanaa, South Africa, directly. There's Victoria, you can go there. The other way is to apply directly to the city. And the other one is through the altitude policy. Although the altitude policy facilitates residencies, it doesn't have a lot of really organized funding to go. The rent is about 5,000 rand a month if you've converted. So, you have nobody else in the central Paris that's living there for that amount of money. One of the advantages, obviously, is the possibility to see museums, to go to art fairs, that kind of things, to visit private galleries. In Paris, all the galleries are annoying, are behind closed doors. There's no sign on the bell to tell you that the gallery is there. You have to know the number to place. They're not interested in tourists, so they're interested in their regular collectors, people who come past, who make possible for them to be there. So this is the Fiat Art Fair, it's in the Montpellier. And so this is some images, I'm not going to really go into it. Basically, it was a big supermarket, like the book Art Fair. But things were sold at amazingly frightening prices. And you could listen in on these conversations with some of the gallerists. It'd be like these granites standing against the wall. Well, how much is it there? How much does it cost? How is it brought in by crane? These kinds of conversations. That is my mess there on the left. And I cleared up a little bit and ended up having a solution for them. So the other possibility for travel is nothing happened that time, but when I went to Paris, I wanted to be in the corner as a space. I didn't pay a cent for the solo show. I didn't pay for my travel. And I put all my things in my suitcase and I had a solo show for 2 days. Which is pretty cool considering I haven't been able to find a commercial gallery to know that I can sell my work and therefore will give me a solo show for less than 25,000 rand on the table before we can start the conversation. So those kind of possibilities, existing countries with social security, and a taxpayer base, a kind of middle class base that can fund these sort of groups. And I'm currently run in the city of Berlin, run by artists. The city pays the rent and the artists run the space. This is from my process. I was working in the consumer waste, something I've been doing for a few years. I'm just trying to make sense of these objects, living with them. And being able to live with these objects was quite interesting and important because I understood them in a new way. My kitchen was a dump, okay? And anyone who came in it was a little bit grossed out. And I give the bar props of everything that I've consumed. It's a project I've been doing for 365 days. So you can't really see this. This is a disused container to get it out. No one was doing anything.
What?
A vitrine. A glass case, like a glass museum case.
Oh, a vitrine.
Yeah, so I'm afraid you can't really see that much.
Yeah.
But I basically had an exhibition in the glass case every few months. It's something, again, that I organized myself. I was particularly interested in the form of the glass case, what it meant, why we want to put something there. And I wanted to put things there that we would consider to be useless. And what was interesting was that they couldn't be falling down. So when they'd be pushed pins into the glass case, they had to stick, and then the lights heated everything up, and the glue melted, and everything fell down. And eventually I realized it was part of the work, and actually we had a lot to say about our ambitions for the permanence of these objects. So it became a failed installation. about 2 minutes. This is ridiculous. Okay. Anyways, notebooks, things as well. I document all of my works because they will only exist on the sidewalk or as performances. I document them in making books. This is a book I exhibited in Dakar. I had the opportunity in France to do something that I made to show my work in Dakar. This is a book with pages of consumer waste. This is the installation that won the Atelier Award, which was shown for the first time in Berlin, because it was never set up properly for the award. Because it was a group show that was in space to set up an installation. This is the performance that I did during the show in Berlin as well, something that I started making in South Africa. It's called Hunter Gatherer. Basically, I collect trash on the street with a suit made out of post-consumer waste. It has many, many pockets. And then I go and arrange things in museum spaces in a sort of way that you might see in ethnographic displays or but they use these things. And so this is one of the things you can do with this art. I extended my stay by 3 months because the people that I was working with said, if it's better you're not here in 3 months, if you were still here in 3 months, you could perform in the sort of company. So I was like, okay, I'm going to make sure that I get 3 months' time. So I did this performance in the Centre Pompidou as a result of, just hanging around in Paris. I must say that to most of my friends, they were not people from France. They were immigrants, most people from the continent. And we had the same issues with the French people, so we were along. These are some books as well. They were in the car, more. Some bookworms. This is from. I travel the performance quite a lot. I don't do it in the Eastern Europe as well. So this was in Zavale, the Institute of Contemporary Arts. I almost got arrested before this. It was like fun. They said I was naked. It wasn't great. I was wearing my doctor's shorts. It was very plastic. But, and then we also started getting into the food art because I'm particularly interested in useful or uselessness, which is part of the Hunter Gathering project. So this food art project, which I started in Berlin for the first time. I then took further on a residency with the University of Free State, called Open Lab, it's a social art residency. And this has been the next sort of stage of this project, which I started in Berlin. And yeah, this is an installation made of toilet paper, which I'm pointing at. I showed it in the car in Berlin as well. And it's sort of a work in progress, and yeah, this is sort of a part of it, which you'll probably see next year in June at the show for the Anthea Awards, and that's me.
Yay!
So this is quite a Yeah, so I could basically spend my time as exactly how I wanted. I could do anything. It's eat all day, I could party all night, do whatever I wanted. No one was checking. So with this open structure and format of the residency, I kept on having to remind myself that there was no expectation to produce, do, or make anything. But this was really difficult. It felt too good to be true. In our culture, we are very goal-orientated and we expect to see something tangible out of an experience. So I use this time and space to think and reflect a lot about my practice. I use this opportunity to see as much as I possibly could and to record, photograph, and collect data with the intention of making work when I got home. One of the best pieces of advice that I got from someone before I went to New York, because I had this anxiety of like what I was actually going to do there, she said, don't expect to conquer New York, and you don't need to give New York anything, let New York give you everything. Because I think I was which galleries am I going to contact, what work am I going to show? You know, I had all this kind of expectation, and she just said to me, just let New York give you everything. And I think that's what it did. So this is what New York gave me. So basically for me, the best way to show you what I did in New York is through the language of archiving and cataloging that I'm interested in using in my art practice. You can view the video over there, and that's, in my mind, exposes, it's a draft copy, there's like 5,000 images to catalog and I've only done like 30 of it, so it can give you an idea of where I'm going. But yeah, basically you can see my internal and mental information systems and hierarchies and how I process and categorize my experiences. This process of tagging metadata, archiving, is something that I'm interested in, an idea that I had before New York, but strongly got developed in New York while I was collecting the data, photographing, and editing. Some projects that I came across while I was there was things like the Google Art Project. I know about Artsy, but like they kind of filtering and tagging system and exhausting a crowd by Carl McDonald, which is an interactive tagging process. So people can go onto websites and actually create their own like archiving system and tagging system in live streaming. So for 2 months, I went to art galleries and museums almost every day. Obviously, I had breaks in between and did shopping and things. Part of the award was access to the American Association of Museums card, which allows free access to most of the museums in New York City. This saved a lot of money because New York is very expensive, and McCandle knows because she didn't have it. So it was like, it saved a lot of money. So that was a huge, huge benefit. So I just want to go through some of my highlights of the experience. So very lucky, 2 minutes. Oh. From Mode, I don't know if you know any of him, he put me in touch with a guy that works at the Metropolitan Museum, and this guy introduced me to the Met Media Lab, and I spent time with the Met Media Lab. They're doing very innovative projects on how we engage with museum practice. They look at VR and just basically art and technology, which is a huge interest of mine. I also got introduced to people that worked in the photography department, because I photograph artwork for a living. And I was really interested to see how the back ends of the museums and how they document their work. You can see in these photos, I went into the archives, where basically like the history of slides of the Metropolitan Museum. And it's exciting to me, I don't know if it's exciting to anyone else, but like basically all the negatives of like the whole history of documenting the Metropolitan collection was in that room on the right. I went to the photography studio, spoke to the photographers, it was very exciting. Deer Beacon is this insane, Max was just thinking about it. Deer Beacon is this beautiful place out in upstate New York. Okay, I'm just going to go through it. Basically, these are some of the artworks that I was really influenced by. Guara, Joseph Boys, Solo Wood. He's amazing. So these are wall drawings. I mean, there's just wall. It's this gigantic warehouse filled with massive, large-scale, like breathtaking art. MoMA PS1 was really cool. They have this party called the Warm Up. So there's Mac over there. We partied and looked at art, which is the combo. disguised at the Brooklyn Museum. I saw lots of South African art. I know it's weird to put a South African art in my display of, speaking about my overseas experience, but I was just filled with so much pride and excitement when I saw all this work. And then just like seeing the super iconic work that we got taught in art history at school and actually seeing it in front of my face, that's amazing. So the stuff I was thinking about while I was in New York, one thing I knew from the beginning was that I wanted to collect data from people around me. I tried a few different approaches, but the thing that struck me the most was the very different skin colors of the social landscape around me compared to that of South Africa. As a South African, where as a white person I'm a statistical minority, it was interesting and though slightly disconcerting, all of a sudden to be a majority in a different country. New York has a reputation for being very multicultural, but I was finding around me that the people around me were very light-skinned. I found that suburbs were rather racially separate and learned that different boroughs are well known for belonging to specific cultural groups. For example, Brooklyn, Bronx, Manhattan, Harlem has the largest percentage of the city's black people, and the largest Chinese communities are in Manhattan's Chinatown and Queens. New York also has a large Hispanic population, and these are a group of people that we don't experience in South Africa. So I had a fascination with how people of various colors move through the city and decided to track this. I was also interested in looking at race beyond the limiting and problematic labels of black and white and to expand representation to a purely aesthetic Pantone color. So developing on from my ginger work that I did, where I developed a color system, I took that into that. I had a notebook with me at all times and would sit and grade people over hours. The drawings I made, I'm aware of the problems, biases, and subjectivities in the work, but perhaps that is what became interesting for me. The subjectivities of classification that are defined by lighting, sunburns or tanning, the colors of the Copic markers that they manufacture, and my small budget that only allowed me to buy 14 colors. So this made me think about the tension of grouping people. On the one hand, people are classified into groups and there's othering and discrimination, but on the other hand, we want to celebrate difference and we don't want to homogenize people. People enjoy being part of the community, having a collective identity. I'm conflicted and started questioning this during the process. This is my last point. So, it's literally the last one. I'll put this down even though I'll talk. So, I also did this by photographing mass dense areas and photographing crowds, and it's something I'm going to maybe work on. And then, the last thing is I constantly feel like I'm looking out in my work, and then about a month into the thing, I had a bit of a personal experiences and art that I was influenced by, and I decided that I needed to start kind of looking within, so I started a video diary every day and started photographing myself every day and just kind of really exposing my vulnerability to the world and then kind of trying, taking my interests of collective identity and kind of working from a more personal space. So that was like quite a shift that I had during that time. And that's it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
So Nadira is a multidisciplinary artist, researcher, and designer. She's also very good at organizing parties. So she was. It was earlier this year or last year.
It was this year.
One-month residency at the Back Factory. It was then mirrored by a one-month residency at the Push. Space in Tehran, in Iran.
Yes. Okay, so yes, as Joseph said, two-part residency. Not necessarily collaborating on work, but sharing a space and sharing ideas. And also, what's great and difficult about doing a residency in your own city is one, you get to look at your own city in a new way. You start to notice things that you haven't before. What makes it difficult is it's hard to kind of separate from your life. So at any given moment, I have about 3 to 5 projects that I'm working on at home, ranging from project management to design to teaching. Having to separate to do a residency, which ideally is about taking time out to reflect on your own work, have time to read, have time to draw or make, whatever it is you want to make, I found it quite difficult to separate from normal life, friends, family, work commitments. So that became quite tricky. And because I was finding it tricky, I tried to find the simplest project that I could do that would still communicate that I had sort of looked at my city in a new way. And that's where the coloring book project came out. So I started, because I was spending a lot of time in Portsburg, Newtown area, I started to look at details of spaces, buildings, street corners, construction sites, signage, and I started to think about creating a project that would allow other people to read the city in a way that I'm reading. So to offer a different, So there was no kind of guide as to what you had to do, by what time you had to do it, what medium you had to work in. It was pretty flexible and open. The only thing that was required was a open studio event at the end of the month of May, which was, we could make up whatever we wanted. It ended up being a big lunch party, which combined South African Indian, South African Jewish, and Iranian foods. And we invited people to come and talk with us about the work that we did. So the coloring book for me was a way of translating the city in a way that could become a way of learning about the city. So through coloring in, memorizing space, or thinking about space, thinking, there's text that goes with words. But there's also sort of like buildings that become UFOs and spaceships. And so I started to pick out elements and turn them into patterns. And we had an open studio, lots of food. I got people to come and color in coloring books with me and have conversations about city space, which I found is a way that I'm much more interested in working in now, because I struggle normally to talk about my work, and this becomes a way of not having to talk about my work but having interesting conversations with people around the table. I find that people become a lot more relaxed when they're sitting and drawing and coloring, and they just start talking freely. So it's a way of me also dealing with anxieties about vision opening. I put a map just because when I decided to go to Iran, actually check where it is I was going. My parents were completely freaked out because why on earth would you go to Iraq? People are dying there, and I had to say no, it's not Iraq. Please, let's get this right. So I was in Tehran, it's all very tense. A lot of political issues. I'll talk about the constraints and restrictions. But honest to God, one of the most beautiful and interesting places I've ever been to, one of the most beautiful people I have ever met. Warm, welcoming, generous, genuinely interested in who you are, what you do, why you're there. Also, you're from Africa, but you're not black. People can't understand this. They constantly can't also figure out how to understand that South Africa is the bottom of Africa and it's a country by itself. So we're constantly referred to as Africans. The Africans in our project, can we be Africans? Which is a bit strange, but I guess you can get that in all parts of the world. Tehran is a big, crazy, busy city, beautiful city, 16 million people. So being used to Joburg, which I thought was chaotic, this is a whole new level of it. Very busy, traffic has no set hours, you're kind of stuck in traffic perpetually, there's no being able to decide when to move or not. This is Kush, I can't really say properly, but it's a tiny little house, it's a three-story house, you live there, you have a kitchen there, you have a studio there, you have a courtyard, and you have a cat, resident clothing cat. So we had an open studio event at the end of our month, happened at a gallery space a little bit further away from Kush. It's a commercial gallery space with a project space, and we got the project space to kind of also play with as openly as we want, with no requirements on what to make, when to make, how to make. It was quite flexible and open, which I find quite difficult to work with, because when there's no structure, you have to come up with your own version of it. In collaboration to some extent with the people that you're sharing thing of taking Polaroids of all of the resident artists. Maybe I should talk about Push a little bit, very quickly. Very young space, 2 years old, and because, so Iran is a difficult place. There are a lot of rules and restrictions around what you can and cannot do, especially when it comes to freedom of expression. There is no arts funding in Tehran, so everything is privately funded. Push is privately funded. You cannot say whatever you want. Post 1979 revolution, an Islamic government, you have to dress a certain way, you have to wear hijab, you cannot use the Ayatollah Khomeini's name in anything, you cannot say the word revolution in anything that is published that carries the name of the art gallery or space that you're working in. So they censor your work quite strictly because they're quite worried that in a public platform like this, if you show nudity or if you say something political, that you are possibly inciting a new kind of revolution. And so they check your work before you are allowed to present it, which was quite a tricky and difficult thing to figure out how to deal with, because you find that you start to self-censor at some point. This is said, I mean, the other artists in the residency, Anthea Bass, and Janan, Amin's wife, who was always part of the group. Traveled a lot in Iran, went to Shiraz, where Shirazi wine originally comes from. Can't have any alcohol in Iran, but you can find whatever you want, actually, if you know who to call. Went to lots of palaces and gardens, ate some of the most amazing food. There's a lot of strange propaganda around, so you can't see. A lot of anti-American propaganda. Beautiful marketplaces, beautiful architecture, lovely little cafes, newsstands everywhere. This is not self-reflection really, but more just me trying to figure out whether I looked good in hijab or not on a daily basis, because it was a totally new thing for me. And this is Bangkok Persian hat. Last image, I think. Second last. The Polytaviat Bridge. Iran has this very interesting relation with nature. It's a very, very big city, and they're trying to encourage people to get in touch with nature. So they built this beautiful bridge, which is called Polytaviat, which is the nature bridge, and it encourages people to walk through a park, over the bridge, and out through another park. So it becomes a kind of family exercise and a kind of entertainment thing. Because there's not really entertainment in the ways of cinemas or clubs or bars. People party at home or they go out and they picnic and they walk through parks. So it's having to learn a whole new way of entertaining yourself in uncertain kind of restrictions. This is in Shiraz. The reason I put it here is because Shiraz is known as the capital of artists, intellectuals, poets, and amazing thinkers. And when I left, I got into trouble because I overstayed my visa by 2 days, and I now have a stamp in my passport that says Police Department of Alien Affairs of Iran. It's a very tricky visa process to figure out, but on the whole, one of the most amazing experiences I've had in terms of art, people, food, culture, tradition, religion, everything. Yes,
thank you.
She's been living in Melbourne for the last 5 years, I've been in Johannesburg. So we kind of wanted a space and a time to work together in proximity. And so we applied to the Nantes Foundation International Residency Program in New York City.
Just press pause, I think.
Yeah. The residency is in Sunset Park in Brooklyn, in the borough of Brooklyn. And we were staying in Harlem, so we had quite a long commute through the city, and for the first week we were very generously hosted by Anthea while we were getting to our other accommodation. The Nantes Foundation is also, it's a self-funded residency. However, we did a hell of a lot of fundraising, and with that we're able to pay for our entire residency without our own money, basically. We had collected enough to fund the 3 months. So yeah, it was a 3 month residency from July to September. It's New York. So yeah, a bit about the project. The way in which Samantha and I have worked, we both have our own separate practices, but together it's project-based, and it's often around a certain topic that we're interested in that we want to research. So for New York, we proposed working with bonus spaces, which are these spaces that are public but privately owned and managed, and it's particularly prevalent in New York City. But when we arrived in this massive place, we were quite overwhelmed by, you know, to use a cliche, this concrete jungle. And we both organically were navigating towards the organic elements in the city. So we then started to look at bonus spaces through the organic matter within the city, and that then also led us to working with weeds and the presence of weeds in the city and where they exist in the city and how they're allowed to exist in the city. And we kind of worked with the weeds as this autonomous thing, and then, yeah, that's how our project unfolded. Also, part of the project was negotiating the collaboration between the two of us and working collaboratively, which was the first time we had done that in the last 5 years. In previous projects, we've always had a very determined project and set out very determined works and kind of everything was set out, whereas this was a lot more organic. We were in the space together, we were working together and constantly negotiating and discussing how we were going to form something. So it was also part of the residency was feeling that out and really experiencing a collaborative practice. Like Anthea mentioned, the NAS Foundation was a very structured residency. As far as I understand, it's also the studio spaces were incredible, massive, high ceilings, amazing lights, located in a really interesting industrial area within Brooklyn in Sunset Park. So it's like on the edge of, by the bay, and it's slowly being gentrified, but the studios have been there since 2001. And it also functions very much in the same way that Assemblage functions, where they've got studios for local artists that rent out the studios, and then they have this residency, international residency program. And then with the residency program, they've got a very rigorous structure where you have studio, inter-studio prints, curators come in to visit and speak to you about your work and what you're doing. And so it was very stimulating in that way. And then also just being in New York, you want to see as much as possible. And there's just an insane amount to see. Every single night there's something to do and see. So our schedule kind of, we were in the studio 5 days a week, and then we'd reserve 1 day to go studio to museums, and then in the evenings you'd go to openings and have a drink and whatever. And also, so with this residency, and just being in New York, it's extremely expensive, and with the rand being so very dire at the moment, it was very expensive. So we kind of hustled ways to get into things, and quite shamelessly, because you know, we wanted to see all this incredible art, and one museum entrance at like the MoMA or Whitney, for example, is $25. I mean, that's just silly. So
it's like over 300 rand.
I was press and I was frightened, which I was in some way. So the project, so we initially started out collecting paper within the areas that we found ourselves in, to then create, to pulp that down and create these biodegradable labels that we had collected edible weed seeds and plant that had embedded in this paper, and then made these labels, and then from those labels we the labels had information about how this weed was edible and what its nutritional values were, and then we very subtly inserted that back into the city in various areas, some that were more heavily surveillanced and controlled, and others less so, and that was kind of a social experiment to see how these little objects would be allowed to exist in the space. So this is Sam busy inserting wood sorrel, bio-wood sorrel that we managed to find in Tribeca, and then observed that over a couple of days was very quickly removed, so we didn't get to see that biodegrade. Whereas others that we had put in Sunset Park, where the studio was far less managed area. It's industrial for one, but also kind of let be. And those labels were allowed to then break down. Oh, really? Jesus. Okay. So yeah, that's the labels, and that's one that's biodegraded. That's a studio crit, that's the studio, beautiful big space, amazing art that you can see at amazing places. That's Deer Beacon, which was incredible to see. And then, yeah, this was some of the work that we made and found. So a lot of our work takes the form of sculpture, found objects, video, more about the project, we have a blog that you can look at the project. This was the first draft of our rescue book for edible weeds. So we, from the edible weeds that we found in the city, we developed a recipe book that you could then make your own recipes from urban foraging. That's an example of a spread. That's a recipe. And yeah, these images are very dark. Yeah, so then this whole project then culminated in, for one chapter in our minds, we still continue with the project bonus space. So this was the first instance of it, and it culminated in an open studio / exhibition at the end. And yeah, and we've made amazing relationships with some curators and artists in New York, and are in the process of doing shows over there. So all the work that we made is back in New York, still with the hope of showing it there. And also because the project is so specific to the location and space, we want it to be there. And this we can apply to any other space that we travel to and go to and investigate. Yeah. So that's information about the Niles Foundation. I would recommend it, but also only if you get funding. It is insanely expensive for international artists, and especially South Africans, but it's well worthwhile, and it's a very rigorous residency. It was great to have the structure that it had. That's the blog of the project, and my information. Thanks.
Great. Thank you.
Woo!
a residency in Finland, at Ateliers in Finland. My residency was very different to everybody else's. I decided, I especially applied to Finland because I wanted to get away. I didn't want to go to a place that was Josie on steroids. So I wanted to go where there was nature, where there was calm, and where there was peace, and also because that fits my practice, it fits the concept that I was busy trying to develop. So I was at Ateliers
in Finland, introduction to Ateliers.
So if you look at the slide, Helsinki is the capital of Finland, which currently is the design capital of the world. Ateliers is just about three and a half hours, slightly to the west of Helsinki, in a place called Hamekiro, Hakijarvi, and that's where we were. A few fun facts about Finland is that it is the third most least corrupt country in the world. I can't believe something like that exists. It's the most amazing country because it's one of the most equal countries in the world. In 1906, a woman got the vote, the first country in the world. It's a great country for women and children to live in. It's extremely clean, everything works. And their water quality is just of the best. You don't pay for water there, you use it for free. If you want to buy water, you're going to pay a lot of money, but it's for free everywhere. So if you go there, you can very easily go to Russia. You take a ferry over Estonia, any of the other countries. So that is the part. Arriving at Ateliers. That is Ateliers. So it is a rural residency. So it's in the countryside and also part of a farming area there. As you can see, when you arrive there, no gates, no alarms, no bars, no crime. We never locked anything. You just drive in. So that is really, really amazing. The facilities in, it's quite dark, you can't see it so well. But the first slide, it's a very long building. That building houses 10 people extremely comfortably. It works very much. These are the studios, and can't really see that because I was very lucky. And the Mexican Australian artist, we actually got given the best parts to look at. We actually had a park, not just a room. The size of the bedrooms are almost double garage size. They're Scandinavian, so they don't have a lot of things in, but that's so that you can do whatever you like in there. And the studios, so it operates a lot like Assemblage in the space size, except you're also living. So the space is like this, but there's kitchens, rooms, everything fully equipped.
So you can get your bedroom, your studio?
You can work in your studio if you want to, because there's a trestle table, good light, lighting. If you want to, you don't have to, you can work wherever you want. There's a lot of facilities which are like this one is the big tool shed where there's power tools, there's all the equipment you need to make massive installations, whatever you want to do. That is the sauna on the left. The proper finished sauna, the best thing ever. And it makes you feel like $1 million. It's one of the things I really miss. The surroundings, obviously it's countryside, these are the lakes, the rivers. You arrive in Finland, everybody has free access to everything. Everybody owns land, free access to everything. You're allowed to walk through the forest, swim, fish, pick berries, do whatever. It's all for the people. And you can do this at any time of day and night, 2 o'clock in the morning. You can go and swim, you can whatever, you're going to be completely safe. As in, as well as in Helsinki, it's a huge city, it's fantastic. I felt completely safe there. It's really great. Because I was with a lot of filmmakers in my group, they were always running around at night, doing shoots and taking shots and whatever. So I was also there during the summer. So we had daylight from 4:30 in the morning until approximately 10 at night,
sure,
which was really nice because, I mean, your day just felt so long. Oh, I don't have work today. And it was just, oh wow, man, we still have some time, which was really nice. In the forests, where I got a lot of my inspiration for my work and a lot of the other people too, there's berries, you can go and pick berries. Finland, there are tons and tons of berries in that country. When the summer months are there, you're allowed to pick them for free, pick them wherever, and you can sell them at the markets to no demands. And this was an installation. It's quite a big one. I was just walking through the forest, and some previous artists and art fairs had made this amazing installation, which goes to quite an expansive area. And those are berries I picked, and then we, I made jam for the first time in my life. Okay, studio. So that was the window. When I looked up at my studio, that was the view I saw every day, and my bedroom window in the same. That was working at night. getting around. Was getting around, there's bicycles, there's a residence car which we allow to use. That's how we go. Our social was, there you can see our group there, we were at Nostalgia Bar. There we were having what they call a cookout, barbecue frying, and at the bottom, after we did a bonfire, and then we decided, well, the bonfire because I was with filmmakers and photographers. Outside, they put up a screen and they put their laptops and we watched a horror movie outside. So, Wall of Fame, that's quite fun. When you end the residency, it says there are many lunatics and most of the great people in the history of the world. So, the Wall of Fame is actually three walls now because there have been about 550 artists to art fairs already, and they are signed by name. So, art fairs is a really, if you want a really great residency to go to, most people that go there, you'll find that just the nature, you go there and, I mean, you don't go to a residency to do stuff you can do in your studio at home. I mean, you let the space speak to you, the surroundings speak to you, and what I really enjoyed about the space was just being able to hear the only voice that I heard in my head was my own voice. And that was really, really nice. And then every day you just created, they also had a system of like here, nobody checks on you. You pay your enormous residency fee, so they've got their money. So it's up to you to work. I was with an amazing group of people, seven of us, we all got on. They usually take about 12. But because they were fixing one building, we were only 7 feet up because we had all stuffed ourselves. And the group was very hard working, which the work ethic was extremely impressive. But we worked hard and we played just as hard, which was really nice. It was balanced, and I mean the residency set up the residents determine what the residency to a large extent. There's a board, socials, whatever we want to do, however we want to structure. If we want to run around, go to Tampere, wherever you can, the nearest city 45 minutes away. So we did a lot of stuff there, got our art supplies, and then there's lots of little towns around. You could bike to them, use the cars. So it was, I really enjoyed it. It was absolutely awesome. So yeah.
Small little island kind of town.
Yeah,
it's golden one. So we met Kazir when in February in the old Assemblage. So he came to Africa to search for African artists. Then Bongani Jalo, he introduced Kazir to us. Then he came to the studio, then we showed him like our work. And we're not sure, like, he wanted to buy, because he said, what's he doing? Then we exchanged like contracts and stuff. Then he told us about like the previous project that they did last year in Nantes also. Like, it was an Asian theme, but they did the project in a boat. It was kind of like a residency also, but like it was in a boat because like they have like a lot of canals. So like there were artists like we were like doing like murals, drawings, there like lots of activities. Then
so Kazir is the representative of the project of residency.com. So Kazir is an art director for a company called Post It, which
I don't know,
Pick It Up production, which are the people that invited us basically. So yeah, so they were looking around like around South Africa. Just yeah, Africa as a whole. So they started in Cape Town, came to Joburg, went to Senegal, then went to
Ethiopia,
looking for a certain style of artists, or a certain look that they wanted. And then they have this building in Nantes.
So yeah, they have this building. It used to be like a printing shop in Nantes. Then it was kind of like an abandoned building. Then the municipality of Nantes wanted to demolish the building. Then was this Pick It Up production. They proposed to the municipality and the whole was this municipality of Nantes and stuff that they will kind of like reserve the building or do something within the building. Then they invited like was this like South African artist and one also like oh yeah, also was this French artist and one from New York, but the artist from New York couldn't make it for the residency. So then in the residency.
The main thing was to demolish the building after they do the search. So all the work that is in the building was gonna be demolished. Okay.
Or maybe like if they don't demolish it, it would rather be people like who can occupy it, like artists, so we can do like activities in the building. So the building like was kinda like two stairs and stuff. Then they were like artists like were given like rooms and stuff, kinda like assemblage. So you have to choose like your room. So everyone like choose their rooms, then we were left with the like a small room which we were going to turn it into.
Did you have to choose your
room? No, it was weird because they already planned for us. So when you got there they gave us this room and said, you guys are gonna make this room like a set of
rooms.
Like a bar.
Yeah, because they were going to use that space as a bar during the exhibition. Then me and him like, okay, we're going to do like stuff and shipping, like beam and stuff.
Using topography from different things that we see during the castle.
Same as like Alphabet Zoo work that we did, right?
So even I think curiosity kind of thing. Anyway, so Kai said something earlier that actually is relevant to what happened to us. So besides the whole residency, we got you know the context and all. So this guy was the printmaker. So we went to this lovely printmaking studio. It was owned by this guy called
Charo.
And then we made those prints with them. So we selected like people that we know have like a graphic guy from the team. So there was 14 artists there. So they selected about 14 people to get to do the work. 14.
1-4.
But we proposed that because like me and Minnie like we printmakers and we didn't wanna like was this like being stuck in was this in painting because like we're painting every day.
It was almost like a 9-to-5.
Yeah, we are kind of like a 9-to-5.
We go to the studio at 9 and then we leave it like late, like 11.
Well, yeah, 11. Because like the sunset, like 10 and stuff.
So the nice thing was that also, so they also had like South African
artists. So like, that was a nice part.
Which was also nice, because everybody speaks French there. Yes. Like I'm the only one in Iceland, kids speak Zulu and English. Yes.
But like, how many, like five South African artists, which was Blessing Bobeni, Juan, and Mimi, and that stuff from Cape Town.
She was also interesting that they were looking for Faith, but they were looking for female graffiti artists. She was looking for Faith, they couldn't find Faith. She was there, next time. And she stayed there for a while.
Yeah, she is.
Yeah.
So in the residency, like it was kind of like we're in the box, you know. Mm-hmm. So the first day when we went to the space, they showed us the space, like this is where you're gonna work. Tomorrow you're gonna meet up here at 9. So me and Minnie and Nat, because we're South Africans, wanted, like, let's understand the city before we develop the work. Because like developing the work, then we don't understand the city. So we're going to mix yourself. Then 2 days, we went around, looking around the city, without doing anything.
Getting lost.
Yeah.
Finding out how small it is.
Yeah, this is
so. Yeah, what's beautiful is just that people just don't speak English, they want to speak English. And yeah, we can't really say anything to them.
So, guys, like, we didn't do PowerPoint because, like,
the video cut it off,
made up, like,
which is quite interesting because the guy that invited us, because yeah, was also informal to us. So, we wanted to make sure if he wants us to come.
And also, know. Like, we're surprised by the email.
Mm, we were like, oh, we.
Was it fully funded?
Yeah, it was fully funded. They even gave us some money for getting our visa, but in euros. Anyways, also we had like we were working. We had like a chef there. We had a chef there. We had breakfast, lunch, supper there.
Drinks.
How many minutes do you have?
Minenkulu, you've got about, I see the video is like 90 minutes.
I know, we'll cut it after our side.
Okay, you've got about 2-3 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll stop for our side.
Was this the video of the whole project?
Yeah. So it's written in French and English.
Skip. Maybe you should skip. Skip it to. Skip to you.
So many things, I mean, just like this as well, without much, you see, yeah, doing public art or street art for about 15 years.
Art.
But,
oh, yay! Woo! The sound's quite distorted. Oh, it's your old studio!
What I can say is that since they gave us the space like, to be in environment, we decided to part of this. It's usually a little segue to South African art. So, a typical South African art would have like, some of the stuff that we worked on. Yeah, the characters that you see on the wall, you will see something like that in Johannesburg. The people that are from different places around Africa and France as well. People that you never even meet, you know.
And it's really a good moment for those people to meet each other.
Yeah.
And it's nice to have a couple of people around this to themselves. So like that was the space, the one like where we had an interview and stuff. That's where we were working, just to paint it out and stuff. So since me and Minnie like we work with was this like typography and also like was this typical faces of Joburg, kinda like was this power shop. Sign writing. We took that idea to France and stuff because like they don't normally have that kind of style, you know. And also like we didn't want to also like lie to ourselves. When a South African person goes there and see the space, same as was this on us, we went to see the show, then he told us like, yeah, okay guys, you represent like, South Africa in a proper way. Because also like when you go to the shipping, if maybe like was a certain shipping is branded like with Amstel Lager, it's gonna be painted like Amstel, or if it's black label. It has to be painted like in black label. But me and Minwe decided to paint it like in castle, because we love castle.
Because like, they had gold and red, and the prints also like spoke to the space itself.
Yeah. So with the prints and stuff, we wanted to also feel the part of like the residency. Because while we were there, we kind of like, as if like we're in a, what's this like, a working project, what's it like, kind of like, let's play around, work, paint. But we didn't feel like we're sharing skills, because that's how the residency is about, like we have to gain skill. Then we proposed to Kazi, like, do you have any friends, since like we have like prints and stuff that you print with? Then he told us, like, yeah, I have a friend, Jerome, but like, he stays like, far on the other side, but like, I can make plans for you guys to print. Then we choose like few artists. Then they cancelled some of our artists.
Like,
And also like we gained skill like in terms of like registering like a large quantity of things like in a day.
That was the most funny thing. Why did we make so many? Because they don't vary prints like us, it's like it's different. Like to them it's like posters and to us it's like prints. I don't know.
And also like the quality of paper that we use is this.
Like,
they use like poster paper, then we use like paper.
And we make lesser editions, because they were like normal, so cheap. We happy.
Cool.
Residencies, the implications or questions that arise about going to another place and being in another context, having a special status as an artist, and they often make some sort of expectation that you engage with or respond to that context and some of the interesting political and ethical questions that arise around that time. But I mean, for again to go back a bit to my own experience, I think one interesting question for me is about the extent to which the models, the infrastructures, the resources around residences are largely located in the kind of American context, and beginning to think about how do we do this in African continent or the South context. In ways that make sense conceptually, practically, financially as well. And this has been my current work has been about exploring residency opportunities in urban centers in South African regions, Kinshasa, Luanda, Harare, and so on. These being very interesting contexts in which residencies can happen, but we have different sense of infrastructure to the ones that one has mostly seen this evening. So those are just some small, a few little comments from me, questions from you. I think that urbans and hamlets can ask each other questions.
Affect a certain project. Yeah.
But for me, the first time I showed in a sense both the rats here in Joburg and then the PCP plastic in Paris, was the first thing for me that struck me in terms of my practice is that the streets there are so clean. And every morning there's a car that comes and scrubs the pavements and scrubs the streets, and they've got, you know, guys that grind the street behind the car, and that felt very odd to me. And then going to the areas of Paris that are more or less privileged and feeling, oh, okay, this was a joke. You know, like, okay, there's stuff to pick up, you know, and there will be fragments. There's not this enormous amount of money spent on keeping the streets clean in those particular areas. So just within one city, basically like Paris, I think that those kinds of disparities do exist as well. And it's one of the things that I had a long conversation with a friend of mine. Paris, and she said, you know, if you come to Paris, which Paris are you coming to? And we spoke about that for a long time. Because there is not just one Paris, but it happened to be that the city is in a place which in the 1970s was a slum. The government paid people to renovate these buildings there. Now it's the most expensive one in Paris. But in terms of my practice, what felt for me was
Around context and context influencing practice. The one kind of realization that I had, which is maybe against that. I mean, obviously your context inspires and affects you. But the one thing I realized was this kind of very intense feeling of everywhere you go, there you are. Like you are the center point. You are the center of like any context that you're in, and you. I think when I was kind of going on this residency in New York, I thought, I'll have this like huge epiphany and things will change and I'll be a completely different person and artist. And actually, like you are the center point, and you are like so wherever you are, yes, you're being influenced by your surroundings, but kind of you are the center of that change and that inspiration, and that was something that I was kind of.
Yeah, speaking about influence, and my question is kind of related to Makandel and Anthea, because you guys were in the US. In reference to the current political like climate of the US and people actually being caught between like the two devils, do you guys have any did the political sphere have any like major influence on you, or was it just some highfalutin sphere? Like, was it as strong as it is in SA?
How do you mean
it
as strong as it is here?
Yeah.
I mean, how we
like
feel the SA context.
Yeah.
I mean, everyone that I encountered was terrified in New York City. I think it was too big a beast to even touch on whilst in terms of the work, but definitely the energy that was there. I think New York City is kind of a bubble in a way where it kind of feels like separate from the rest of the United States, where they kind of consider themselves very different from everyone else. And also, I mean, the city itself, it's one of the most diverse places in the world.
Yeah.
You know, there's so many different people from all corners of the earth. Like, it's just a big pot of salad. We're trying to make ends meet. But in terms of art, I think my perception going to New York, like investing in this experience and exposing myself to that environment, I wanted to kind of understand what
is the big fuss about it. It's I think any artist going there with no definite mission is just insane. Like, it's so saturated.
No, it is. It's a revolting city to try.
I really enjoyed having a very distinct project and mission there that I could go and I could investigate, I could research, I could look, experience, but that there was an endpoint, that I wasn't just going to try and survive this and like survive that space and like get in with the right gallerists or whatever. It's like, wow. It's just amazing.
Yeah, I think it's important to be realistic about it.
Yeah.
The entire city is kind of see where it fits, who loves you, and you know that you've been well and interested. So I met a number of curators from South Africa, whatever, like name dropping, you know, doing so and so. Because I know these people. And then when they kind of realized, oh, but I know Stephen's an artist, then that was kind of the end of it. You know, so there's people are very aware of the picking order here, and in terms of South African artists, and who certain curators will be interested in, and the people I end up working with are more activists, a lot of them street artists, a lot of them interested in working with communities. So I guess you can kind of find your
space. But I think that's also another interesting point about going on a residency is you do meet, like part of the benefit of it is creating a network in that place. And meet
but
you're
not
going to
click with everybody.
No.
Galleries and that place, you might have an expectation. Yeah. And then suddenly you meet this person you never, you know, you thought you might meet, and that's then
the
person that you have to be really, really just open to listen to people and be figuring out.
I wasn't going to say anything a lot. I was just going to say I didn't find more than just social conversations, I didn't feel it, the political situation. You know, obviously every person that I met there was a conversation and, you know, but I don't know. I think, there's a level of distance that we were allowed. I mean, I think if a foreigner came to our political situation, they might feel the same, but we're deeply invested in our own environment. So I personally didn't feel it, but it was definitely a topic of conversation.
And also, well, it does affect the rest of the world, America's politics.
Yeah, but he's asking if when we were there, did
you feel it? I want to ask one thing. You know the residency you did, right? I don't know if you mentioned it. Do you get invited by Mr. Kimberly yourself, or do you have to apply someone?
So there's no application, but there is a board of trustees. So it's not just a sole individual. There's a board of trustees, and I think I read this. I don't even know if it's a fact, but so previous fellows, people that have been invited before, they can nominate people, and then like that's the long list, and then the short list goes to the board of trustees, and then they select the short list. There's only six opportunities a year. No, not even that much. There's only like four opportunities a year. So they pay for flights and accommodation, and then living expenses.
And living expenses are
huge.
Sure, yeah. That's pretty intense.
But I mean, it's
very good to New York.
It is intense living in New York for 2 months. Yeah.
Well, yeah, our.
But free museum access,
yeah.
Which was huge,
okay, yeah, yeah,
actually. So when you like spend a day in a museum, that's your.
In terms of the Artelaise residency, they are very pro South Africans. Because when you do research, it's actually amazing to see how many residencies have never had a person from African continent as their residency.
Really?
That was one of the ways, another reason why I chose Artelaise as well, because when I went through them, I saw that they very partial to South Africa, Jennifer Schell and Swaggerman, of course, they are some people that have been there, Robin Cook. And I was the 10th one to arrive there, and there's been two more since. And so that is really, I don't know what the reason exactly is, but that's one of the things that only cash uses though is an expensive residence.
It's all fun. Either from themselves or relation to a network of connection into that. place that can actually land up being quite not such a generative experience. What is interesting though is for Swiss artists coming to Southern Africa, they often come with quite an open-ended brief, and they have extremely, they almost almost without fail, they have really profound creative experiences that really change affect their practice. That is not so much the case for Southern African people.
I know I've had conversations about this with the Zavale Foundation, and I mean it's very isolated. It's an island, in the middle of nowhere, and to send somebody there who does not speak German is a very difficult thing for them to do, because you know people just don't communicate. And in Paris, particularly, I think my first 3 months were very difficult because it was winter. And my French, I was still working on the French. And sooner or later, he realized if you don't speak French, you know, you're going to run into severe difficulties. But the most interesting realization for me after 3 months was that that's just a cultural thing. We have this British colonial thing. I was like, what is my culture? How am I so different from people? And there is just this British colonial thing of taking certain things apart, introductions and parties, you know. It's not the French thing. The British will tell you the French are rude, the French will tell you the words are fake. But basically, if you're at a party and you speak to someone for an hour, they're not, and then you join them in a group afterwards with their friends, they're not going to say, hey, it's so and so, I just met them. This is not something they do. And you're like, this is kind of weird, you know, like how does this whole thing work? And eventually they accept it, this is not a thing they do, it's a cultural thing, but it's these tiny little nuances, even the country that you were colonized by, determines the way that you're so used to interacting with people and expected to be treated in a certain way, and when people don't, then it took me a while to just realize, well, it's just not what they do, you know. They're not trying to be funny, they're not being horrible to you.
And you also spoke about the challenge of this kind of open-endedness, of this having no particular brief in the context of the samples and seeing what you can do.
I was just about to say as well, like the lack of community and network. Very obviously the type of person that seeks out community. I mean, one of the founders of Assemblage, that's the whole basis of it. And like, I'm someone that needs people around me and I need to bounce ideas off and need to talk about stuff. And so that was really challenging for me. It was very, very challenging being on my own in that aspect. There were a few things that I did to try and help that. Was the Make Media Lab. They had this every Friday, they called it a collaboratory day. So you can come and spend the day at the Make Media Lab and just like work on your own stuff and just like chat to people and like it's just like an open workspace. So I took advantage of that a few days. And it was just like this whole community that I could tap into, and I was like so desperate for it. And then I visited Mac in her studio a few times, actually only once. The intention was more, but
too much to do.
Yeah, so Tinder's great to meet people. Tinder's great to meet people. Seriously, it's a good way to meet people when you're in a foreign country.
No.
No shame. It's a great way to meet people while you're traveling. I met lots of people that I hung out with and that showed me cool places. And I mean, otherwise, how do you meet people in New York City? I mean, seriously. Very isolated, and I have no shame, and I'm pro Tinder. There was no community for me to tap into, and it was very difficult.
But I think that is what's great about going on a residency, like with South Africans going to Switzerland, and experiencing such a different culture, such a different landscape, that kind of gives you a whole different bunch of lenses, or to clean your lenses that you look through
you know, and like, that's great, you know, because it does challenge you.
I just started a group, I just remember this now, but like, kind of like a peer group mentoring. I started a group like that.
Did you do?
The organizers really didn't understand, and eventually they got it. But the only people who came to the group were people from outside of Western Europe. So people from Scandinavia, people from Australia, anyone who didn't live in countries where they had people who had contacts within France and Paris. The rest of them were all like networking the shit out of the city, and the other people didn't really have a way to access the networks within the city. So those people to our other group, and it was a way to get to know people. And I started it too, because yeah, when I got there initially, it was like, who are these people?
Can I just close it? Just close my laptop.
But then write the project as well.
And eventually, I must admit, the last few months I was there, I was one of those people who didn't have time and was, oh, it's too busy, sorry, you gotta see so and so, there's a show here. And I find myself sort of caught up in this overwhelm. And that's maybe the other thing that would be useful to speak about is when you go to a place like that, I mean, in Paris, there are about 5 awesome art events every night to go to. Once you, you know, get hold of your Facebook calendar and you see where everyone else in your residency, that does another thing on Facebook. You add people on Facebook and see what events they're going to. Was also a way to kind of tap into what the more interesting events were in the city. But once you really get into that, you realize just how much is going on, and then you can start making decisions. Mm-hmm. And if you come from a place where there are less things like that going on, it's totally and utterly overwhelming. Mm-hmm. I mean, for me, I shut down and I want to just stay home and do my own things. It's too much, but I can't deal with it.
So you've had experience with both this kind of European context of institutions and so on through your time in the Netherlands, and now this experience of a very different kind of context in Iran, Tehran, which is somehow maybe a sort of, in some ways, closer to our experience than say, the European experience. And in thinking about what residencies might be in our national, regional, continental context, what thoughts might have come out of that experience for you, both at a practical level in terms of how do you finance, how do you work, what sort of resources, what sort of infrastructure is really needed to make meaningful experience, and then to kind of central as well.
Firstly, choosing to go to Iran was to do something that I had absolutely no idea about. So I knew that if I chose or applied for residency in Europe or the US, if I had got accepted for something, it would be possible to find the networks, to find people who knew people who had been there, to make connections, to find funding. I opted to go for the most difficult group of things. And therefore the most interesting one, because of economic sanctions placed on the U.S. Placed by the U.S. on Iran, there are no funding structures available at all. So you have an Africa Mobility Grant, which allows African artists from the continent to travel to Europe, Americas, Australia, the Middle East, but not Iran. Yeah. Iran is the only one kind of cut off all of the lists, which meant that. So on a practical level, it meant that it was self-funded in the way of I just worked a hell of a lot. I took on about 4 or 5 design projects in the run-up to the residency so that I could make up the money. And to be quite open about how much it cost, it's about 10,000 rand for a flight and about 15,000 rand to survive a month there. And that meant paying for all of my food expenses, travel around the city. Taking a metro subway system there is very cheap. It's about 2 rand a ticket for 4 hours of riding the metro back and forth. So it's quite cheap in some senses, but quite expensive in others. But 15,000 rand in terms of food,
transport, any kinds of shopping that you want to do, and production of work. So they had absolutely no budget for the production of work, but they had an amazing support system in the sense that they introduced us to everyone that they could possibly think of. And what I found is a contrast to what happened at the bag factory, because it was an exchange program. So say that I'm in, came down and spent the month here in May, and so we went up to Tehran in July. We were taken around and introduced to a lot of people. They were not actually introduced to artists, taken to parties, taken to dinners. So that kind of difference of structure I found a bit problematic also, and I felt that we should have done a lot more on this side to make other artists welcome and to introduce them to the right people here so that they can make further connections to come back at another time or allow other people to come. This was the first Iran-South Africa exchange that has happened before. So not only the first South African artist, but the first African artist in this particular residency. I think Richard Penn has been to the sister space of Kush, which is called Raiban. He had been there for a project about 2 years ago. So very few African or South African artists have been there. And what they're trying to do, I think most of the impetus comes from the Iranian side, which is a drive, since the dropping of economic sanctions, a drive to introduce as many people as possible to their culture and take their artists out to travel as much as possible, to start creating bridges that were non-existent for a very long time, that have been so closed off and so constrained. Completely lost your question now. it was difficult to make it happen. Working just like absolute crazy to make up the money and then take time off from what would have been normal work time. And I remember with Zakara, we talked about going to Push. We both talked about applying for this thing, and she was like, but self-funded, how is, you know, this is difficult. It's a difficult decision to make, to say I'm going to take this month and this month off work to go make art, but then I don't have money. So, and then I'm going to use up all of this money to go make art in the place.
Yeah.
But honestly, residencies are, I think, the best way to visit another place. Because you both get to travel and see things and meet people, but also make work and work through ideas that you have about what it is you're experiencing. Alright,
because for artists you have to, part of your application is you do send in a proposal, and obviously that's part of how you are accepted, but they do just say fine, you're not bound by it. And when you get there, I mean, most of us, you've applied a year before you get anything proposal, and everybody leaves with something completely different because you've responded to. But I have to say to you, in relation to the whole funding money issue in South Africa, it really is stressful. It just does add a stressful element, although you, the amazing thing is what you do learn and how you do learn to cope and how you grow, but it is a stressful thing. When you're sitting with 16 to 1 and everybody else is.
But that's why
2 to 1 or 1 to 1.
That's also just a double cost of your cost of home. You know, if you're paying rent or that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, for years I would get accepted and I had to say no because of that sort of thing and because of work commitments and that sort of thing. And eventually we got bored, but after I took all my stuff in storage at my dad's house and I love traveling. And when I'm here, I live in a commune and, well, that's that. And yeah, I've been working full time and the entire year. But that's the life mark. That's the only way that I'm actually able to do most of the stuff. That and the credit cards and everything. Then you actually pay it off sooner or later. You work for a while. And, yeah.
No, I rented out my room on Airbnb while it's gone. I had a colleague to do my work. So I've taken my clients.
It's a car.
I just want to say, like, so in my line of work, other than being like, in an artist, which was a dream, but not at a table. I work with students and a lot. that we represent and artists who are not making like the amount of money that you think they're making, and artists that want to come to South Africa and be able to produce and stay like in Johannesburg or in like big South Africa. And there's a lot of opportunities out there actually. Like it's just a matter.
Studio space accommodation that you can, you're not going to live in Kenya, but you can find, and you don't have to stress about things like what am I going to eat and so on. What is interesting though is that we don't actually get that many applications for these residencies, and the ones that we do get, I mean, the one small piece of advice that I would give to anyone who is interested in that part of our work is that this thing I was saying earlier on about really having application that is sort of thoughtfully and contextually motivated. Not I am a wonderful artist, I have fantastic work, and Switzerland is so lucky to have me, but actually a reason for you to be there as opposed to Finland or New York or some other context, and I think this is something that is really often overlooked in the way that I've seen about residency applications.
But it's something I see with artists of social security in Europe and doing the amazing residency applications, because it takes a long time to do it compared to what some people I know here manage to do in their short time on a weekend or whatever, and they send the thing in. But the standard just it's not the same.
Well, the applications we get from Swiss people are actually worse. It's really people think that because they're important
places. It's something that I've learned. I had an experience at one point where a friend of mine applied for something the same thing as I did, and she got it and I didn't. And I said, hey, can I see your application? And I just wrote to it. She studied in Europe, and you know there are some things that I think there's an enormous amount of time for you to experiment with graphic design, prototypes, documentation, those sort of things, which possibly you know your writing applications is aware.
My question is, why does it seem like it's more complicated to get a residency intercontinentally? Like, I'm not very interested in the US or Europe. I want other African countries. Why is it more difficult?
Because there's less money. I mean, we have much more pressure from people. People are much more interested in the finance that we provide for mobility residencies projects within the Southern African region, from artists from different in the regions than for the Swiss projects, and as you can see, people are much less interested in that, much more interested in working in countries in the region. And that's sometimes that's part of our work, but the big problem is that there are far less resources for that intracontinental mobility exchange and connection. Our fund is very unusual. Be able to finance that without any reference to Switzerland at all, without involving Swiss artists, institutions, projects, organizations, and the mutilated handful of those kinds of funds that are those artists moved Africa, which is a Belgian fund, and that also enables this kind of mobility connection, but not nearly at the same level as the kinds of residency. So it's essentially an issue of where the resources sit, and they mostly sit within these wealthy countries.
It's interesting. The only place I was possibly eligible to apply for funding to go to Iran, which is on nobody else's list, was the Prince Klaus Fund, which is based in the Netherlands. Because they have a grant, a travel community, a travel grant, but then they also have project funding for for a thing called art in times of crisis.
Yes.
My thinking was to kind of write a proposal that sort of looks at censorship and lack of freedom of expression in Iran, which is what my proposal was based on, looking at how people make work. Think about producing work when you cannot say a lot of stuff publicly. But I didn't get that because it was not considered a big enough issue in terms of art in times of crisis. The idea with that is looking at countries where heritage is being destroyed. So they push money into preserving situations under war, pulling out stuff from museums, and saving cultural heritage. And they have money for that, but that was the only funder that was possible going to Iran. There was not much else. And the question of, I think, why are there no spaces on the continent? There's also lack of funding for building residency spaces or project spaces on the continent or maintaining them. That's on the one hand, firstly, being able to run a space on the continent is very difficult. And then to have a residency program that allows people to travel back and forth and training more differently. And that came across when Sen and I were running the substation residency project at FITS, which looked to bring African artists. Hope was that eventually we would be able to have a press exchange, but it was just not working out. But also bringing African artists, bringing someone like Nastya Mosquito to South Africa was difficult because he's from Angola and there's kind of restrictions on his travel. So it's actually a lot harder to do things on the continent than it is to go to Europe and to go to the US, which is a problem, I think.
More than anything, I found that it's more expensive.
Yes.
To do things here is much more expensive than to go abroad.
If you're an artist in Assemblage, for example, in the DRC, it's much financially much easier to collaborate with someone in Strasbourg than in Johannesburg.
Just like in sort of continental flights, even to go to like Zambia, which is a 2-hour flight, is the same amount to go to like Berlin.
But the reason for that, I think, is because there's no demand.
Can we not reach out to, because I mean, artists exist from everywhere. It's like, you know, doctors and lawyers and candlestick makers. But can we not reach out as like a collective to people in kind of into Africa? Because I mean, Africa is a country, like, we need to take advantage of that and find kind of these artist collectives and studio bases within Africa that we can actually exchange with. Like, I mean, that's been something that's been interesting to me and something that I dreamed about. It's just like working in the intercontinental scale of art because, cool, it's so great to go to Paris or Berlin or New York, but like we should be making work within our continent and to kind of find a means of bridging that gap between us. Is that not something that, as like even a Johannesburg collective, we should look into?
Well, I think we all agree with that.
Yeah.
I mean, Vance has done some stuff like that,
I think one of the usual things with like doing a lot of stuff but not very much money. And that is the reality for the moment.
That's always the thing. It's money. Because even the international gap that we might exist between internet correspondents, which I think less money, that can be something interesting studies.
There is a network really interesting spaces that has emerged across the continent that are increasingly connected with each other. So I think it is starting to happen. So we'll take time.
Human resources, that's like the money, but human resources.
mostly, because Assemblage, we started a residency program last year. Actually, Roberta's one of, we had two residents, Roberta from Australia and Bettina from Germany. But we also really wanted to focus on the African continent. But like, we needed funding for that residency, we needed someone to run the residency. So Zach, if you want to run the residency, we would love to create something like that. Yeah, you know, we do, that's one thing we really want to do, and we just don't have anyone that's doing it, so the sentiment is nice, and the like, desire is great, but like, who's
I know it's like this kind of like dream that's kind of unattainable in terms of money, always, but at the same time, it's like, I'm just thinking of, and it's like finding the right people to fund those things, like, people who support art, for example. Like, I'm not sure what kind of Assemblage is, like money basis in terms of if you have collectors or whatever. I mean, from the city I come from, like, there are people with means and people that have the interest, which is, like, I think very important. And, in, like, people should be supporting the arts that, in terms of artists that are not represented and are making exceptional work, and that should be like rewarded for that. And at the same time, not necessarily like buying their work out like ridiculously, but making opportunities where artists can travel and learn and produce even better work.
That's what the Ampersand is.
I can speak very quickly because it caters to a few artists and it also caters to members of the WAM staff, the Guitar Museum staff, and it's very, very selective and it doesn't reach out to everybody.
Yeah,
exactly. Like something that's more.
I was thinking of the Zimbabwe and I was just saying that show in order.
Oh, they were my, they were residents, as well.
I know because I met him in Amsterdam and he was at the Rex Academy, Fantastic work.
So I'm
struggling to make work. He started up his own farm in Zimbabwe so that he can earn some kind of income in order to reduce the work that he wants to make and to travel.
I think that's a very important. There's a huge amount of South Africans in the world, but it's very constant to doing. So, for example, there's a contemporary dance company that runs a residency in Kisanga. Congo, they sustain that through two things. One is a more familiar thing, which is international touring of their work in the States and in Europe. The other, which has become much more important, is the financing, setting up an operation, water sanitation.
So things that are kind of socially engaged, useful for community, practical, and just considering ways of living, space that you live in, as a part of how you think about yourself as an artist and how you think work and how you connect with other people. Immediate community and environment as equally important as the production of work, conceptual thinking on the side. I think, and that's something great I've learned from Admire is that idea of like, oh, farming is not kind of simply gray in terms of like where you want to be, thinking and what you do. It's actually a part of being an artist, being a maker, being a thinker, being a producer, that all of that comes together.
It's
also farming.
I think if we can conclude, maybe a bit of the time, to thank Assemblage for all these things.
Thank you.